Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our series on the virtual ambassador and diplomat experience. Global Cleveland is thrilled today to be hosting our friends from Germany. We are very fortunate in Cleveland. As many of you know, we have many descendants who come from Germany, who have moved here from the beginning, not only of our city's incorporation, but also the founding of our republic and before. We are fortunate that today His Excellency, Consul General Wolfgang Mössinger, who has led the Consulate General of the Federal Republic of Germany in Chicago since 2019, will be headlining this conversation and will be our first speaker in discussing ways in which Cleveland and Germany can do more together economic developmentally, educationally, and culturally. Mr. Mössinger has served in the Federal Foreign Office since 1987. He has worked in Senegal, Ireland, Ukraine, Russia, Azerbaijan, and Finland before coming here to serve in the United States, where he currently lives in the city of Chicago. Additionally, we'll be hearing from some other representatives who will be discussing the German-American and German-Cleveland-American relationship. Mr. Benedikt, the Director of German Academic Exchange Service of North America and the Director of the German Center for Research and Innovation New York, will also be speaking today on our panel. And we're fortunate to have Mr. Mark Tomkins, the President of the German-American Chamber of Commerce and Industry Midwest as well. We're very fortunate to have today on this call and someone who has helped lead the German-American community in Cleveland for many, many years, Mrs. Diana Thimmig, the Honorary Consul for Germany in Cleveland, for her continued support of the German community in Cleveland in Northeast Ohio, as well as her excellent work as an attorney and somebody who constantly reminds us of the strong bridges that exist between Germany, the city of Cleveland, Ohio, and the United States. We're also fortunate because here in Cleveland, we have prominent German Americans who lead, whether it's Mr. Fred Geis, who was born in Germany, who came to Canada and then immigrated to the United States, who has built so many of downtown superstructures, somebody who always talks about the importance of his German heritage, or whether it's Mr. Jack Schron, a gentleman who started a company after his father began it in a very small way, who now produces products that go throughout the world in the medical community and other places that are needed for his manufacturing expertise. Somebody who talks very often, not only as a German-American entrepreneur, but also as an elected official in our county council. And may I just remind everyone, before I turn this over to Mr. Mössinger, that in downtown has a beautiful plaque that we cannot wait to show the Consul General when he comes, commemorating that in 1683, the first people from Germany came to the United States with Franz Daniel Pastorius, their leader, and it occupies an honored position in our downtown in terms of the annals of German-American involvement, a settlement that comes here as the German Mayflower. And may I add today, of all days appropriately, a leader to be one of the first people in the New World to formally oppose slavery in 1683, 338 years ago. With that spirit of liberty, entrepreneurship, and brilliance, may I present to you His Excellency, the Consul General of Germany, Mr. Mössinger. Mr. Mössinger.
Thank you, Joe, for this very kind introduction, and thank you, Elizabeth, for organizing this Global Cleveland event today. I'm very honored to represent Germany in Cleveland, a city with very deep German heritage. I'm also grateful to Benedikt Brisch and Mark Tomkins that they joined me today and will speak to their specialities later on education and business. Let's start again with a little bit of history. The Germans played, as Joe just said, a crucial role in the development of Cleveland. They came in different waves. We know 380 years ago, the first one, but then they came in bigger numbers in the 1830s and 40s, once the Ohio-Erie Canal opened. They wanted to escape economic depression, like the crop failure in the Rhineland in the 1840s, religious persecution and political oppression, particularly after the failed 1848 revolution. And some became famous craftsmen, brewers, furniture and piano makers, farmers, educators, doctors, and priests. the latter one serving in more than 120 churches with services in Germany, in German. The most numerous group came then in the 1880s and 1890s. In the interwar period, the places of origin and the composition changed, mainly Donau-Schwaben, who came from the areas lost by the Habsburg Empire, and Jews, albeit those had difficulties to obtain visas. When immigration in the US surged in the 1950s and people came from Latin American and Asian countries, Germans were already part of the bedrock of the local population. Immigrants from post-war Germany came mainly for jobs, for education, or for family as spouses of US Army personnel. According to the 2000 census, 10% of the population of Cleveland claimed German origin, a number that has probably likely decreased because many moved into the suburbs, and few are still born in Germany. In 1980, they were about 10,000. Interestingly, if you look at the national level, Germany is still the country with the highest number of immigrants from EU countries. 2018, over 500,000 Germany-born residents in the United States constituted 1.2% of all foreigners in the country. But looking back to our own country, in the meantime, Germany became a country of immigration herself. Starting in the 50s with 12 million refugees from Eastern Germany, which was occupied by Soviet forces. If you imagine 12 million refugees in the early 50s, a huge number in comparison to today's foreign-born population of about 9.6 million. Then we had the first wave of Gastarbeiter from Italy who arrived in 1955 and until the formal end with a recruitment stop in 1973. In the 1980s, we had ethnic Germans from the Soviet Union, about 2.5 million. Between 2011 and 2015, foreigners came with, from new EU member states, was always, again, almost 1 million. And in 2013-14, a wave from Western Balkan states came to Germany. That wave brought about some changes in legislation, and it was a difficult political balancing act between harsh foreign policy measures like visa restrictions on the one hand and trying to have integration measures at home on the other hand. But the most recent and possibly most politically controversial wave arrived in 2014 to 2016 with refugees from Syria and Iraq, about 2.1 million in these years in total. About 1.8 million of them applied for asylum. In 2019, 26% of Germany's population were considered to have migrated in their own generation or in the one before. That is our definition of having a migration background. They constitute roughly 20 million out of our 80 million people. 52% of those have acquired the German citizenship in the meantime. And 28% of these German citizens are second generation migrants. But still, 80% of those who have not got a German citizenship have personal migration experience, which means about 7.5 million people. So how did Germany fare with this influx of refugees? You know, there was a big difference to previous waves. These people brought with them a completely different cultural background. But put a look at the positive side. They are much younger than the average population. And they come from middle class in their country of origin as costs for transfer are very high, about 6,000 euros per person. Many are members of minorities in their country of origin and therefore amenable to democratic values of tolerance. Of course, such a high number in a short period of time causes problems. Some of the refugees suffered from post-traumatic stress disorders. Some had anti-Israel feelings due to propaganda in countries of origin. Some were badly educated or not at all. The last decade brought about a shift in perception in Germany. an acknowledgement that we are de facto a country of immigration. After many years of soul searching, we have then made some legal and societal progress. We have speeded up asylum procedures. We have managed to get almost all refugees to participate in integration classes, and 50% attain a level of German language on the level B1. We have managed to get all children to school, and we have better equipped and prepared teachers. But unfortunately, too few still go to kindergartens. We have managed to put 75% of these refugees in permanent housing. And we have included them into our health service as much as we can. And the most important thing is that more than 50% of these refugees have now regular contact, private contacts with Germans. But there's still a problem, especially on the job market, where it's a very slow progress. And after 5 years of residence, only around 50% of the refugees have found paid jobs, but earning only about 55% of an average salary. And 50% of all those in working age and conditions still rely on social welfare. So in Germany, we have now, with many, many decades, even centuries later than the United States, started a discussion about belonging. What is it now to be German? Are we a melting pot? Are we a salad bowl? The development of a common base of understanding is difficult without a predominant religious or traditional set of values. New Germans, including Black Germans, for example, with growing self-confidence and identity, and then triggering discussions about guiding culture. What is the Leitkultur? What is it to be German? President Steinmeier once said, becoming German means acknowledging and accepting our history, which is, of course, rather difficult history. On a bigger scale, migration is one of the most profound crises in the world. It is the symptom of deeper causes like insecurity, persecution, poverty, environmental degradation. And Germany and the US are one of the most popular countries for migrants. That is why we need to tackle these issues together, together with a community of democratic nations based on common values, reconciling possible diverging interests. Some of these issues are climate change. Of course, we welcome the return of the United States to the Paris Accord and look forward to working together on moving the world faster toward goals that mitigate climate change. And I know that especially here, the Great Lake areas is very sensitive to climate change. Then we have to counter together the threat of liberal democracies that are mounted by countries like Russia and China and their influence on our political debate, including cyber threats. We welcome the initiative of President Biden for a summit of democracies. We have to defend ourselves together against ongoing security threats and international terrorism. We would like to counter these threats in a common defense strategy based on who can provide what best and not only on looking numbers of budgets. An issue long neglected and coming now to the fore is global health. Of course, at the moment, the most important issue is the rollout of vaccines worldwide. Germany provides 2.1 billion euros and around 203 million doses via the COVAX facility to 100 countries in the world. By the end of the year, we'll have more doses for 142 countries. So we have almost exported as many doses than we have administered to our own population. The WHO is a necessary organization to distribute and to advance research, and we welcome the return of the United States into that organization. Now, coming to bilateral relations. They have remained stable on the level of businesses, even if there were disputes on a political level. The US-EU trade relations are the single most important driver of global economic growth. These two trading partners count only 10% of the world population, but produce almost half of world GDP and they are each other's best customers in goods and services. We should use our weights to set the standards for trade and investment in the 21st century with global markets and fair international competition. Then we will have the clout to stop others from cheating. If we fight each other first, remember, former President Trump once said Europe is worse than China, then we will be set against each other. We also need to set standards in the digital economy, or our big tech and not governments elected by the peoples will dictate the rules. And we have to prepare ourselves against attacks from the same foes that attack our liberal democracy. In bilateral relations, of course, people-to-people contacts are most important. They carry relations forward even if politicians disagree. This means develop business contacts, to which Mark will say a few words later, develop academic cooperation, the remit of Benedikt. Very important too are schools and the teaching of German. I would like to mention the German language school in Cleveland, founded in 1960 by Donauschwaben, now part of our partner school network, located in Olmsted Falls and Novelty. The Saturday schools that teach German up to a high level. And we would wish that more school districts offer German in high schools in Ohio. And in the cultural field, I would like to draw your attention to a project in July this year when Germany supports the Borderlight Festival in Cleveland, presenting visionary international theater. And this year, Germany will sponsor the performance of a German theater group called Rimini Protocol. They adapted their plans to the pandemic situation and will present a project called The Walks, in which patrons will download an app that will guide them through landscapes like the Cuyahoga waterfront, debuting in 21st to 24th July, but the app will be available for 1 year. So you see, we have a wide array of cooperation, including cooperation with Cleveland. Some of these small projects nevertheless foster cultural and personal relations and are very important to keep these going. So thank you very much for your attention. I will turn back to Elizabeth and I look forward to your questions later on.
Thank you so very much, Consul General Mössinger. That was wonderful. I would next like to introduce Mr. Benedikt Brisch from the DEADD. Benedikt?
Yes, hello. First of all, it's wonderful to be part of this exciting conversation today. And I want to thank Global Cleveland and the Consul General, Mr. Mössinger, for making us being part of this. It's an honor to be here. And you introduced me already. My name is Benedikt Brisch. I'm the director of the German Academic Exchange Service Regional Office North America, located in New York. And also, you see the view from our office here in New York City. And I'm also the director of the German Center for Research and Innovation for the US. So the description of today's event mentions business and education. And this is actually education especially, but also in a partly business, is where the DAAD, the German Academic Exchange Service, and the German Center for Research and Innovation have something to offer. If you want to know more about what we do and what we can offer, please look up for DAAD.org or Google German Center for Research and Innovation, New York, and you'll find us. Just briefly, the DAAD is an independent member organization of the German universities, funded publicly, mainly by the German Foreign Office, the Ministry for Research and Education, the European Union, and other sources. So, I would now today like to highlight a number of tools that we offer, and that would be interesting, I hope so, for our audience, people related to education or research or business. I start with scholarships. One main tool that the DAAD offers are scholarships. So we believe some of our scholarships are interesting for the audience here. On our website, you will find examples, a lot of different scholarships tailored for students and researchers, starting with university summer courses to get a first experience on the campus of a German university, We offer scholarships for internships in research and industry in Germany with the so-called RISE program. And we offer, of course, long-term study and research scholarships at German universities, quite similar to the Fulbright program. So students and researchers from the Cleveland region might just look up our programs and apply for them. And we would welcome that very much. Any scholarships we offer are always provided based on a merit-based competition, and independent experts and reviewers decide who gets the scholarship. I would like to highlight one specific program that we have. We also offer, and one tool that we have are complementary to the scholarships is a project funding for partnerships between American and German universities who want to work together on a regular basis, or who do already cooperate but seek for new opportunities and funding. So if among the audience here are people who work for universities, this might be interesting for you. So we have a brand new program we came up with in the middle of the pandemic 2020. And this program is called the International Virtual Academic Collaboration Program, IVEC, financed by the German Ministry for Research and Education. Last year, we implemented this program and we were able to fund 61 projects as of last year. And we have spent a budget of 5 million euros for it. Please Google IVEC DAAD, so International Virtual Academic Collaboration DAAD. Program description you'll find fully in English. The new call is out for this year only since last week. And the next deadline for applications is May 25th. So here's the thing, only German universities can apply, but they always need an international partner. Without a partner, for example, a partner from Cleveland, they cannot apply. The idea is that German and American universities arrange joint or linked classrooms where American and German teachers teach German and American students together, where the students work virtually together on projects. So as we work now on this video connection. And at the end of the course, students and teachers get the funding to buy tickets to travel and actually visit each other and meet and finish their project. And this funding is provided for both sides, for the American side and for the German side. And then finally, I'd like to when I come to the end, I want to highlight the activity of the German Center for Research and Innovation that I'm also the director of. This is in center, the German Center for Research and Innovation, was founded on the initiative of the German Federal Foreign Office, which is currently promoting and financing five such centers around the world. And they're also located in Sao Paulo, New Delhi, Moscow, Tokyo, and here in New York. The goal of this center here in New York is to bring together scientists and innovators from Germany and the US in order to solve questions of the future on a global level. And most important, the DWIH, or the German Center for Research and Innovation, is a member institution where you find all big German research institutions, the German Research Foundation, Helmholtz Society, Max Planck Society, Fraunhofer Society, and a number of German universities. And of course, the German American Chambers of Commerce are also members. So if you're a representative of business, of innovative technology, politics, university, or a research institution, and you have contacts to Germany, or you want to establish contacts to Germany, please reach out to us. Look at our website, German Center for Research and Innovation, New York. We offer virtual debates with distinguished experts on many topics like urban design, future of work, artificial intelligence, and so forth. Please sign up for our newsletter, sign up for our events, and become part of a transatlantic space of creativity, research, and innovation. And the next event, and with this I come to an end, the next big event we plan as a hybrid conference in October 15th, 16th, will be located in Chicago. And we plan it as a hybrid event. It's called the Future Forum. This year's Future Forum 2021 is dedicated to the topic of societies in transition, impacts of the pandemic. So we're experiencing more than a year of the pandemic, and now we want to turn the page. We want to bring together innovators from university and industry to debate and create and prepare decisions about the future. What technology, what innovative design, what solutions do we need for a resilient, thriving society of the future? And we're happy that for the Future Forum in Chicago, 15th, 16th of October, we're teaming up with the Consulate General and the German-American Chambers of Commerce Midwest. So thanks to Consul General Mr. Mössinger and thanks to Mark Tomkins, President of German-American Chambers of Commerce Midwest. So if you're interested in the Future Forum, please sign up for our newsletter. There will be more information about the event. You can sign up to participate either in Chicago at the location or remotely from home because it's a hybrid event. So with this, I come to an end. I thank you for your attention and I also look forward to any questions later. And with this, I give back to Elizabeth.
Thank you so much. That was fascinating. And we will most certainly be following up regarding some of our sister cities' education work. And thank you for letting us know how to sign up for your newsletter. That was so informational. Next, I'd like to pass it to Mr. Mark Tomkins.
Well, thanks, Elizabeth. And after everything that's already been said, maybe there's not much to talk about, but I'll do my best. Really, on trade and business, the EU has the trade policy hat on for Europe, and then certainly the consulate and the embassy working on a macro level. Our role as the German-American Chamber of Commerce is really on the micro level. We work closely, obviously, with our partner organizations, especially the consulate, but we're part of a global network as the GACCs. It's the AHK network. You can see the logo above my shoulder. We have 140 offices in 92 countries around the world. And so it really functions as a network, even where, let's say, German companies in the US also might have responsibilities in Canada or Mexico. And just about an hour and a half ago, I was on the phone with my Canadian colleagues. So it is a very broad network globally. Here in the Midwest, to give you an idea of the importance of the Midwest in German international trade and investment, our chamber is the second largest globally in that network by revenue. So that says something. The only one larger than us is Shanghai. So that kind of shows you where you can see the importance of German trade investment, specifically Ohio. There's about 35,000 employees at German companies in Ohio. So German business matters in Ohio. And those spread throughout the state, including in Northeast Ohio. The German Machinery Association has their data that German companies in the US in the machine building industry employ well over 100,000 Americans. To put that in perspective, that's more people employed at German machinery manufacturers in the United States than the US steel industry. So if you look at that importance of where these companies are, most of these are the Mittelständler, the mid-sized companies, you know, the small family-owned, mid-sized family-owned companies that are the leaders and usually their little niches. We call them the hidden champions. And maybe the thing for the viewers here in Ohioans too is if you're looking for a job on our website, we have the GACC Talent Network. So if you want to work for one of those good German companies, we have our job postings there or come work for the chamber. We have about, over 50 staff here in the Midwest. So that also gives you a size comparison of, you know, what German business means here in the 14 states that we cover. Maybe another way to get involved with that transatlantic business side are, especially due to or thanks to COVID, we have loads of virtual delegations. You know, historically, those have been people moving back and forth to meet partners, business partners in Germany and the US. And Ohio's always been an important participant, including Cleveland and Team Neo. You know, we've had water technology. One coming up here at the beginning of May is our MedTech Cluster Exchange. And happy to say Cleveland's been part of our exchanges there. I'll put a link in the chat for one program that, or as part of that cluster initiative, that on May 6th, there's a 3D printing for the medical industry exchange. with a focus specifically on Ohio and working with Jobs Ohio on that one. There's also going to be conversations throughout that week around digital healthcare, the legal framework for it, and what we can learn from Germany and the US for moving digital healthcare forward. Certainly a big topic where Cleveland in the medical segment is very strong. Then the follow-up, though, is at the end of June, we're going to have a virtual delegation to Germany. That one's limited to 12 representatives from throughout the U.S., so a little bit competitive in there to get the best delegation from the U.S., again, virtually, so we don't actually have to travel to Germany this time. But all that information is on that link for if you're in the med tech sector to virtually at least go visit Bavaria. Means you'll have to bring your own beer and have that at home on your session. But Hamburg, North Rhine-Westphalia, so the key spaces in Germany where you see med tech happening. There are lots of other programs we're running, so I won't talk about all of them. There is one that's called Leadership Through Crises. It's really re-emerging from the pandemic. And every month we'll have a different topic throughout this year. And that's one where also if, you know, as those topics get announced, where there's expertise from Cleveland to share transatlantically, we'd love to have the point of view from Cleveland of people to speak for those. So really that's gonna cover everything about emerging from the pandemic from specific industry functions. The one next month is going to focus on the German tool of Kurzarbeit. So it's a mechanism to keep people employed at their companies where the state picks up basically the unemployment costs, but they stay employed at the company and just work less hours. So that's the focus next month, but other ones are going to be industry specific again. There's going to be one on food and beverage down the road. So lots of different topics as those go forward. And certainly then also literally every day or two, there's a new event in our network. And thanks to the virtual nature of that, pretty much everybody can participate regardless of where they are. So the events list is in there. And maybe just the couple more points. You know, German subsidiaries in the US came through the pandemic really strong. 92% in our January German-American Business Outlook that we released, 92% are planning to increase their investment here in the US. So coming through a pandemic, that's a pretty strong sign. Only 10% signaled that they had a loss on their US operations last year. So that's 90% were able to stay profitable and not lose money through the pandemic. So that's a good sign as well. And the other thing that you see coming from Germany right now is, so those are the companies that are already in the US. The companies that aren't here yet, that are still over in Germany, the interest is higher than probably we've ever seen. The first 3 months of the year we run, also thanks to COVID, we were running a lot of virtual workshops with German companies about how to do business in the US and particularly through the pandemic. The first 3 months of this year, we've had over 800 German participants in our workshops and sessions on how to do business in the United States. So there's this huge pent up demand right now of German companies saying, hey, I wanna come and build a business in the United States, which is great for the whole country. And specifically what we've seen historically or in the last couple of years for the Midwest. So that's one that going forward, we're going to have a lot more demand of these companies. Many of them are starting virtual to start with, and also looking at hiring staff and building their US operations. Pretty much the one single largest challenge right now for the companies is being able to travel to the US thanks to US restrictions on travel from Schengen area, from Europe. And we don't know when those are going to be lifted. So that's the biggest question out there right now is when the pandemic allows when people are allowed to travel from Europe right now. It is a little bit disconcerting that there are other countries that have much worse COVID situations than Europe does where there are no travel restrictions. So that's one that I'm hoping will get addressed sooner rather than later. And then the other big question is, you know, the number two challenge companies are telling us now, and it's usually number one, is finding skilled staff, finding people here in the U.S. That have the skills they need in order to build their business here. So that's one we're always looking for partners and friends to continue expanding, also with our apprenticeship programs throughout the country. So Wolfgang already touched on it, so I won't go into it too far along. The German teaching in schools is another issue that those school districts that keep German strong also tend to win more investment, because companies love coming and being able to see, hey, yeah, I'll have staff that maybe they aren't going to be fluent, but at least they can relate to our headquarters location, they can relate to their colleagues around the world, and that it's not always done in English, or even if it's done in English, they'll have a better understanding for those colleagues back in Germany. And quite frankly, the districts that have strong programs tend to get more investment too. So with that, I'll leave it there and we can go to questions. And thank you for having
me. Thank you so very much, Mr. Tomkins. Again, a fascinating set of programming coming up. I definitely am interested in all of those events that you mentioned. I would like to open now to questions and answers. So if anyone in the audience has a question, please put it in the chat and we will work it in. Thank you for putting the links in the chat very much. I will start with a question on workforce development. So I know Germany has programs around healthcare workers and whatnot, where they, you know, put out requests for healthcare workers from different countries and they can come and work in Germany. So how has immigration affected the skills gap in Germany? And knowing that we have a federalist system here in the US, you know, what can local states like Ohio take away in terms of best practices?
So I think you better take this question, but I think Mark might have something to say for that as well. So later on, please. So we are also a federal state, of course, but these issues are a little bit more centralized in Germany than they are in the United States. To attract specialists, we have opened up a completely new path for traveling and working in Germany. It's called the Fachkräfte Einwanderungsgesetz, a nice long German word again. It's meaning immigration for specialists to Germany. They have a very short cut path to obtain a visum. And of course, the medical sector is one of the sectors which was geared to be targeted with this new program. And even here in the United States, we have in Chicago, in our consulate, we had quite a high number of interest in that program. And I think that is what we take away from it. We were far too long a country that kind of deceived itself by saying we are not a country of immigration, but now we are. We have been for a long time, but we simply didn't acknowledge it. But now we have acknowledged it. And once you have acknowledged that, then you can actually start kind of setting up programs in which you target especially the people you want to attract to come to Germany. That doesn't mean that we close down other paths, but it is then a more active policy to reach out to those people we want to attract to come to Germany, instead of simply kind of trying to prevent all those we don't want to have. And this is making a huge difference also in the culture in Germany, in our public offices, where people have then to be registered and so on and so forth, that there is a new thinking. We want these foreigners to come because they help us to keep our economy going, especially when it comes to the skills gap. The medical sector is one of the most kind of needy sectors in this respect at the moment. So I always a bit hesitant to teach others what we do, so others should do it as well. But if that's an experience, of course, the United States has always been a country of immigrants. So you have a much, much longer experience in designing this type of programs than we do. But what was encouraging when we had this wave of refugees, at least in the beginning, there were twice, I read this figure only lately, there were twice as many people engaged actively in setting up all kinds of support for these refugees than ever people voted for the AfD, for our right-wing party. So we have many, many more people who are actually not only kind of tolerating and accepting it, but supporting actively foreigners coming to Germany, especially those in need, kind of asylum seekers, refugees, and so on, but also others. And then the last point in Germany is, it's very hard to find somebody in Germany who doesn't speak English anymore. You have to go in the older generation, in the rural areas, maybe. But if you go into companies, if you go into towns and associations and whatever, you will always find people who speak English reasonably well to communicate with you. So that should not prevent anybody to come to Germany for working or studying or whatever. The universities are offering now many, many courses in English, especially on the level of master courses. So that is a sign of opening up if you actually are prepared to speak the language of those who come into your country.
Thank you. Mark, do you have anything you want to add to that?
Well, I think what we can say is we've learned some of the lessons from Germany's centuries-old apprenticeship program that really dates back to the guild times, but adapted that then to the U.S. And as I mentioned, traditionally the number one challenge for German companies in the U.S. is finding skilled staff, and that across the board, regardless what industry they're in. So we set out several years ago, it started out as kind of my spare time project of creating an apprenticeship program modeled on the German model here in the United States, obviously adapting it to the situation, and that became the ICAT apprenticeship program. And we do have a cluster of ICAT programs out in Cincinnati. We don't have one up in Cleveland yet, but really the driver is getting companies together that say, hey, yeah, we all have this need. These are mostly, again, mid-sized companies, you know, not necessarily the giant ones, so we have big companies in it too, and they say, hey, I'm looking for advanced manufacturing technicians. And with that, bringing training model over from Germany, working with the community college, but it starts with the companies because that's where the employees are based, and every single apprentice starts out by getting a job at that company. And then they also go through it. It's a three-year program. They end up with an associate's degree completely paid for by the company. And at the same time, then a career path going forward. So it's proven to be very successful, so much so that now 70% of the companies in the program are U.S. companies. So it's not just a German solution. In fact, it's predominantly not a German solution. We just learned from Germany's experience in how do you build that next generation of talented employee that then some of them go on, you know, get an engineering degree, get another business degree, whatever the further career path is. And some of them stay on the shop floor. It really depends on the needs of the company and the capabilities of the employee. And so that's one that's been growing around the country. And certainly one that, again, starts with those first companies wherever we can get a cluster of companies that say, hey, we'd like to get this going and support it. But you know, it doesn't start from the politicians. It doesn't start from the colleges. It starts from the companies saying, hey, we're committed to this model.
Thank you. Benedikt?
Yeah, it's a wonderful question. And I just wanted to add to the things that were already said that Germany, as Mr. Mössinger already pointed out, that we have seen a shift in Germany in the understanding of the society and in also a lot of laws and regulations. That's, I can definitely confirm that. And when it comes to universities, in recent years, there were implemented new regulations that allow all international students to stay in the country after graduating for a while for practical training. And in the case that the company is saying that this is really a very important skilled person that is needed and required, there are ways to stay in the country. That was not before. When I started to work for DAD 23 years ago, that was not the case. So we've seen change here. And I think this also shows that Germany is really interested in highly qualified, skilled people from all over the world.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, the next question, let me just pull it up here, that we have. So this goes to healthcare. A couple of times healthcare was mentioned, the MedTech cluster, the May 6th event. So given that Cleveland is a healthcare leader around the world, how can we as a region with German leadership develop more partnerships to the benefit of our two nations and the world? Is that working directly through your offices? Is that trying to work with existing partnerships with the university? Sort of how do we foment and strengthen those bonds?
I would like to refer this this question quickly to Mark, but just let me say one sentence in advance. It is a very open field at the moment, because after pandemic, it will be even more open, because the lack of support for our medical professions has never been so clear than now. And the demand of personnel will grow, because we have seen now what happens if we do not have enough personnel in that field. And I think that from that point of view, there is from top level research to the level of care in a home is now a completely new thinking of this business and of this industry, so to speak. And I think that's why we are very interested in hearing from partners, especially from a big med tech city like Cleveland, if they have interest in working with Germany and what type of interest they have. And that's why I refer to Mark, but also probably to Benedikt, because it includes business and it includes academia and education.
I can only agree that it has to be an all of the above strategy, and tying in all levels of society, whether that's academia, whether that's business, public policy, et cetera. So maybe to start with a point, I was on a call this morning with the chairman of the German American Chambers of Commerce, Crispin Teufel, who his day job is running LinCare, which does home respiratory care here in the United States. And they grew rapidly prior to the pandemic and just literally couldn't keep up. And it comes back to his number one challenge here in the US was, again, personnel, finding the people to keep up with that changing sector, also so they could help move people out of hospitals faster. But the long tail now is going to be the people who were sick with COVID that don't recover in a couple of weeks. So what does that look like going forward? So that's just one small example that they're helping solve right now in one small niche. And so really our goal as the German-American Chambers is help build some of those relationships. That's the nature of that MedTech cluster dialogue, is to bring those key actors, particularly linked on the business side, together so that they can keep going after, without needing us day to day to make that collaboration work. But find the experts in Germany, find the experts in the US, bring them together and let smart minds do their thing, and that's the secret sauce. Now, where we can stay involved, happy to help and keep that going. But the ideal is we bring like-minded, smart people together, and they'll find good solutions moving forward.
If I may also briefly add to that, of course, healthcare is really a field of extraordinary relevance. And it was before the pandemic, but the pandemic has shown that it is really huge. And it's also a huge business and technology potential. We will see innovation there that we can't even imagine in the upcoming years. And let me briefly touch upon a few maybe differences between the American and the German healthcare system. So what is very working well in Germany is it's a publicly funded, affordable healthcare system that provides high level quality healthcare for a lot of people. But the challenge is in Germany right now, if I'm not mistaken, to get enough well-trained personnel. That is really a key challenge. And the American system is very good at training and training fast, highly qualified people for the healthcare sector. So for example, one difference is that nurses and nurses practitioners in Germany wouldn't study at a higher education institution, whereas in the US they do. And I know from many German universities, colleges, and universities of applied science that they're interested in learning from the American experience, how to prepare a highly qualified personnel. So I could imagine that bringing together the educational sector here, universities, universities of applied science, colleges together to think about what can we learn from each other, that would really be a big potential for the future. And we would support that, of course.
Thank you.
Let me just say, add one thing, and really lately, I mean, thousands, tens of thousands of Americans have been vaccinated now with the Pfizer vaccine. The Pfizer vaccine has been actually developed by a German company, BioNTech, in Mainz. And BioNTech has been founded by two Turkish brothers. I say Turkish brothers, which is completely wrong. Germans of Turkish origin. So we see two things. We see, first of all, immigrants help us. In this case, they are really the leaders of vaccine development, coming from a second generation Turkish immigration family. And the second thing is, they teamed up with Pfizer because it's a smallish company. They developed the vaccine, but they couldn't roll it out into millions and millions and millions of doses. And that's why they teamed up with Pfizer. So I would always like to say it's the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine and not just the Pfizer vaccine. But this shows, again, the benefit of worldwide cooperation on the research level, but also on the business level. So take BioNTech as a good example for two things: what immigrants can do to forward the economy and the society of the country in which they move into, and the benefits of economic, of global trade. Sorry for interrupting the discussions.
Wolfgang, I am sorry I didn't mention already. I got my second BioNTech Pfizer vaccine dose yesterday. So.
No, I think that's a wonderful point. And, you know, many of our, the head of the Cleveland Clinic here is an immigrant, right? UH is led by an immigrant, right? I mean, the contributions that foreign-born individuals bring to our countries as a whole, but, you know, on a very micro level, cannot be underestimated. So I appreciate you bringing us that point. I'd just like to see if Honorary Consular Diana Thimmig would like to say anything. Diana was gracious enough to help put this together. We appreciate all her work with the German diaspora here in Northeast Ohio. Thank you, Diana. I know she's held this position for many years, and we have some other honorary consulars on the call today, as well as the Consul General from Slovenia, Ms. Alenka Jerak. So thank you for being here.
Welcome, and thank you very much for organizing the event, Elizabeth.
Thank you, Diana. We appreciate you very much. And so with that, I would like to say that we have our Sister Cities Conference coming up this fall. This is an international conference that deals with many of these issues. I hope all of you will join us, and I'm looking forward to following up with Benedikt and Mark on particular panels for the conference. My mind is whirring with ideas. If I could just ask one last question, Benedikt, about the student exchange, where the program partnership where they work together and then at the end receive funding to travel. Is that, what level is that for?
Actually, it's allowed for all academic levels. Yeah, so it's for undergraduate students, graduate students, and even PhD students. So we didn't focus on a formal level here. We wanted to, our interest it was to support virtual collaboration, because in a time of pandemic where people can't travel what they usually did, we want them to continue to cooperate. And we believed, I would want to bring in here two more thoughts. We also believe we developed actually the program before the pandemic. We had it prepared, but we needed to convince people that we need this virtual approach. But for what reason? We had mainly two reasons. One is climate change. We have seen academic mobility and all mobility growing all the time, business mobility, academic mobility, everybody's traveling, but we have climate change. We have the carbon footprint. We can't see the growth rates increasing and increasing. We must also offer opportunities to work internationally, to study internationally, to do research internationally with reduced carbon footprint. So one way to come to a solution is to say, you don't need always to travel, but part of your research work or for your joint study in for your study abroad experience, you can do online, like we work online. And then the part where you travel is it's less travel, still mm-hmm. travel, but less travel. And the other reason for this was also that we said there are many people who don't have the means and the background to be able to participate in international collaboration. So I want to say that we were talking about migration today, diversity. I know this is the debate in the US, and people from different backgrounds, let's say if your parents are not coming from university, if you're not used to traveling, or if you have to work for your studies, you don't have the time and the money to travel, but virtual exchange allows you to start and then at least be part of it, and maybe later being able and prepared enough for academic exchange. So this is offered for all levels, and the idea is to make it more inclusive and to have a more diverse group of people who are participating in academic exchange.
Well, thank you. I know that's a big consideration for us regarding sister cities, so that regular people can participate even if they can't fly halfway around the world. So the benefit, one of the sort of odd benefits of the pandemic, right, is that we've jumped on this bandwagon faster. So we appreciate your foresight in planning that program. And I will definitely be in touch with some universities who I believe might be interested. So I just want to say thank you to our incredible panel. Thank you, Consul General Mössinger, for being here, Mr. Brisch and Mr. Tomkins. I learned so much. I know everyone in our audience learned so much. Cleveland deeply appreciates you, and we look forward to welcoming you when you can travel safely to our beautiful other city on the lake.
Thank you very much for having us, for having opened your series to Germany today. They've invited us, and as Willy Brandt once said, to be German means to be numerous, so we came out in a team of three, not just one. I hope you we could show you the breadth of our activities here in the Midwest, and to the benefit of Cleveland and Ohio. And I would like to echo also your thanks to Diana Thimmig, our honorary consul in Cleveland, a rock for our cooperation in Eastern Ohio. We hope that we can intensify all what we are doing in the next couple of years by being present in person. But of course, as Benedikt said, always keeping in mind our carbon footprint. but I think we have a lot in common with Germany and Cleveland and Ohio, and I think we can benefit from that and we can build upon that in the next couple of years. Thanks for having us. Good luck, stay healthy, and looking forward to meeting you in person.
Likewise, thank you everyone. And this is being recorded and will be available on our YouTube page in a couple of days. So thank you all. Have a great afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.